in other words, the more you guys can talk amongst yourselves and riff off of each other, I think the more dynamic this potentially can be.
You can't be shocked by too much in the world. You know, things happen everywhere, but it did come as a surprise to, you know, watch the release of the video and, you know, from there, just kind of following the story and just seeing, you know, all the people gathering in the city. A lot of what you see on the news as far as the destruction and the rioting and the looting and stuff like that. What was a bit, you know, it's not really what I think about when I think of Minnesota. But the one thing that I did see that, you know, kind of was very encouraging, as probably a lot of other people saw, was the diversity in the crowd at the protests and how the city came back together to, you know, try to pick itself back up again, you know, after, you know, a week or a week and a half of, you know, protesting and people trying to let their voices be heard.
I think for me, personally, just being in Calgary in a different country, seeing it all from afar, is crazy. And initially I was really scared for the kids in that community, the families. As a community that I believe I'm heavily involved with my work with ACES, around that Lake Street, a lot of the schools that I visit. So that was my initial thought. And then seeing all the craziness that ensued from initially the protests, and then them turning into riots, and then people not even from Minnesota coming in and, you know, damaging our city and Lake Street, you know, that really hurt me, knowing that there's a lot of small business owners on that street, minority owners, that were probably already going through some very tough times during the pandemic. And now to throw this on them, I thought was just awful. But at the same time, and saying that, kind of living vicariously through my friends in Minneapolis, seeing what they're doing, you know, handing out water at protests, supporting, you know, peaceful protests, seeing guys come together and collect groceries, hand out groceries in the community, and be there for one another, and see how our community has come together. Just from afar, seeing that, it has made me very proud of the city.
Yeah, I think for me, it was also, you know, it's just kind of scary to see that. And last year was my first year in Minnie, so, and I already love the city, so to see it, you know, kind of being destroyed like that, it's hard. And I think it's also really encouraging, though, to see not only people come together in Minnesota, but all over the nation, all over the world, coming together for this cause. And like I said, it's really encouraging. I've never seen anything like this before, bring people together like this. So I think the amount of change that it will bring, I think it's been doing, we've been doing a lot.
All right. I've had some awesome conversations just through the last couple of weeks. You know, conversations that aren't the most comfortable either. You know, a lot with my white friends, who are still learning and you know, they're reading all this. It's super cool to have these and come together and have a sense of understanding that we've ever had. And it's terrible that, you know, a tragedy of this magnitude was the inevitable, you know, boiling point for all this injustice and police brutality. But, you know, to see people, you know, willing to change and listen, and just give that attention to the subject has been really cool. And I think we all can agree on this, that, you know, change isn't comfortable. So these conversations are tough, and they give you chills. And even thinking back to them right now, like, I had one of my best friends, we never talked about anything of this sort of race, of, you know, what's going on in the States, or how it's different than living in Canada. And he kind of just poured his heart out to me, and, you know, it finished with like hugs and tears. And, you know, I'm better friends with that man's now, for that conversation. So I'm hoping other people are having those as well.
Yeah,
I feel like for me, go ahead.
Yeah, I think for me, the conversations have, you know, pretty much been all over the place, as far as, you know, the different topics, to, you know, how to spark change, to, you know, resources and outlets, and, you know, how to make friends in different communities, different cultures, or how to even begin to start those hard conversations about informing yourself. So I've tried to talk to a number. I've talked to teammates, people within the organization. I've had a large number of people, whether it was friends from college, you know, some of my closest friends to, you know, just kind of more so associates, reaching out, showing support, but, you know, reaching out and wanting to, you know, hear some of my experiences, or, you know, trying to get more insight on how they could, you know, continue to learn essentially about what's been going on, and how to put themselves in a position to be more aware. So I think it's all been really good dialogue, from trying to understand and trying to not be naive to what's going on around you, even though you might not be directly affected. It's a lot of the conversations I'm having, a lot of the effort is being put in from that standpoint.
My conversations have been pretty positive like that too. It's definitely uncomfortable to have those, but I've had a bunch of friends reach out asking me how I'm doing, how my family's doing, and like you said, kind of try to educate themselves. And then also, like with my family, my mom is white, so having those conversations with her side of the family is really uncomfortable, and it's something that we've been doing my whole life because she comes from a really small town in Missouri, so they're not very educated about just diversity and the struggles that people who don't look like them go through. And so they've even like been posting stuff on social media, and, you know, I've had to message them and have those conversations with them that what they're putting out is uneducated, hurtful to me and my side of the family. And it's definitely uncomfortable, but I think it's brought us closer together because it's kind of forced them to see our side, and it's not something that's general happening to other people. It's happening to people who are in their family. So I think it, like everyone said, it's hard to have those conversations, but it's for the best. And in the end, it's brought us closer together.
I would be echoing what everyone else is saying, you know, just trying to commend people that have reached out and, you know, they've had those conversations with their parents or their relatives, trying to do what they can to put some action in their lives. And that's kind of the biggest thing that I've been trying to communicate with people is not letting it just all die once this conversation or once this kind of initial phase or social media outburst. And, you know, there's a lot of media attention to it now. Like, once that's all done, where are we at? Like, are we going to revert back to life was, you know, a couple weeks ago? Or are we still going to be taking baby steps and making little micro actions to lead to some sort of change? So it's, I've been trying to stress that in the conversations, you know, whatever actions that look like, whether it's, you know, passing stuff on social media and, you know, educating various people, your various followers, you know, what it looks like, you know, going out to protest. It might look like this conversation we're having here, being on a podcast. It could look like, you know, volunteering at a school. It takes various forms, but finding out what actions that you need to take so this doesn't just die off in a couple weeks. You know, this is something that we need to revisit again in 6 months. This is something that we need to, you know, have a checkup on in a year time. Like, what progress have we made since a year since George Floyd's death? Like, what has changed? And you can start seeing it within the police departments, you know, the different laws that Minnesota's trying to pass and they voted on. But the biggest thing now for me is, you know, yes, the talking good, we've established that. That's the first part. We need to talk about it. But now it's we need to do some action.
Yeah, I like that point because too many times in the past, this has all been swept under the rug, right?
100%. And
that's what's cool about just being here on this with y'all, is the fact that we are athletes and we do have a platform to, you know, hopefully amplify those voices in our community. So I think through real to get real change, you need long-term commitment and involvement. So, you know, I'm challenging, you know, everyone in our community and all my friends to do the same and not forget about this as well.
Yeah, just to touch on that again, or anybody else that wants to chime in on that, because it seems to me that that what you folks have is a gift in many ways, with your athletic talents, but with that comes the platform, comes the forum to really possibly enact change truly. How important is it to use your platform? How do you plan on using your platforms, given as though there are so many eyes on you?
I think for me, since, you know, the incident happened and just prior, I've always just tried to really push any content that helps with, like, you know, growth that can add anything positive. So whether it was humorous, informative information, that's kind of been my message, is to, you know, challenge people to continue to try to develop, grow themselves as a person. And to continue to chase their dreams, was what my message was prior. But since things have been popping up, I've been using my platform a lot more to raise awareness. So specifically, I would say trying to share other incidences that could kind of point to the disconnect, and where, you know, one person's perspective, why we feel this particular type of way. I believe just today I shared a video where two African-American teenagers were essentially approached by law enforcement for potentially jaywalking. But they said where they were walking was in a neighborhood without sidewalks. So not particularly too sure on, you know, the laws and, you know, whether that would be considered jaywalking, but there weren't any cars around. But they wanted to stop and question, you know, question them. So I was kind of just pointing out that, you know, in that particular situation, if you don't know if you're jaywalking, but you stop and you're asked questions, you know, you try to handle it in the most positive way. But, you know, just trying to point out understanding that if you do know the law and you know you aren't jaywalking, but, you know, an officer may want to detain you or question you, how that can be perceived by the person who's being questioned, that they were potentially being targeted in that situation. So I try to really just point out instances where, you know, for somebody who may not really understand what it is they're watching in one scenario, I try to give them multiple ways to understand or show different examples of inequality in situations. Just because, you know, if you get one example, but you don't quite understand it, then you may not actually feel like there's inequality going on in the video, or because you've never experienced or, you know, felt that particular, you know, stereotype, because you may be a, you know, a white American man in today's society. I try to point out different situations where maybe it's not about race, but just how would you feel in this situation as a human being? I feel like some situations are easy or a little bit easier to point out, but I always try to trigger who's ever watching or the viewer who's watching to just look at it from a perspective of, you know, not black and white, but how would you feel if this was you? Or how would you feel if that was your nephew or your mom or your uncle in that situation? Because I think the more we can create, you know, that connection and be more relatable to one another, it's when we're really going to spark and get that person to engage and actually want to, you know, partake in becoming an advocate for, you know, police brutality, or whether that's racial inequality, and simply just become part of the change, even though they aren't directly affected by it.
Yeah, I like that. Especially the points when you're talking about perspective, because I think there are a lot of people who take the time to see the different perspectives that you can look at a situation through, but there is a whole group of people who only see it through one lens. And honestly, that makes me sad for those people. So I'm happy that Ant is doing things like this to kind of get people to start thinking and kind of advocate that change and a different way of thinking and how you approach situations.
Yeah, that's true. Getting people to like look outside their own bubble, like you guys said, like perspective, you know. Even I have my own bubble that I think, like, I won't touch into politics, but if you're following certain people on social media, you only get one perspective, so you think the whole world thinks that one way, or, you know, and that applies to so many other things, but everyone has their own bubble, and they don't even know what someone else's life is experiencing or what their thoughts are, and this, it can become dangerous when applied to certain situations.
You know, I think nowadays, you know, with social media, you do have to be aware on the content that you're sharing because it can be false information. So I think that that's a step that, you know, everyone still has to be aware of. But I do believe in, you know, trying to, you know, get the experience or the perspective or try to put yourself in the place of someone on the other side. So I do have like some videos of, you know, law enforcement, you know, how they express and how they feel and doing some of the positive stuff, because, you know, I do want to put that message out that, you know, we can't put everybody in one box or, you know, stereotype everyone just by the actions that we've seen for a few. So I think that, you know, trying to push a message with a happy balance of, you know, obviously, you know, some of these people right here may feel this particular way. Some of these people feel this particular way, but it's really about, you know, trying to understand and really view it from the opposite side of the perspective, so you can be able to make a, you know, educated and, you know, and a good decision for what's right. And maybe even just getting a different perspective that may change how you may handle particular situations or, you know, how you may view other individuals.
And when you see that kind of stuff on social media, especially when it has a lot of likes, people just automatically assume that it's true. Like if you see something, and especially if it makes you feel really strongly, you have to research it to make sure that what you're seeing is actually the truth.
Yeah, just to touch on this and just everything that everyone said, I really liked the point that you guys were talking about, just saying putting yourself in someone else's shoes, because you really can't put them in a box, like Ant said, because for all the people who are bigots, like racist, like uneducated people, there, I hope deep down, and I know this, that there are more of us who are willing to, you know, love one another and, you know, are fighting for equality and justice. So I think we can drive out that hate out of our society, and what we're doing and what all y'all are doing, being leaders in the community. I think that's one step towards it. And I know it's something that's going to happen overnight. You can't just eradicate racism just like that, but I think it's breaking it down to into almost, you know, like how I break it down into game into periods in hockey, and how Ant does it with quarters. You know, you start here, and you know, you attack get on the youth and teach the youth, and then you get to the next quarter or the next period, and you know, your objectives change, and you continue to keep growing, and hopefully at the end, you know, you win the game. So I'm excited to be in conversations like this with y'all, and I hope we can have more.
I was in kindergarten, and I was just playing like with my friends on a slide, and then she said, we can't play with you anymore because you're black and we're white. So that was kind of my first thing. And I grew up in Jeff City, Missouri, which is a pretty white town, and it's kind of a small town. And like my dad, he's like, he came to America from Sierra Leone in 1994. So he has, you know, dark black skin, and for his job, he has to wear a suit. And when we would go to stores, he was wearing his suit, like everything was fine. But if he was just in casual clothes, people would like follow us around the store to make sure he wasn't stealing, things like that. So just from like, and my mom is white. So we've kind of had these conversations from early on, just based on where we lived and those kind of experiences.
And I got a different kind of story. My mom was adopted when she was very little, from Filipino heritage. She doesn't know anything about that. She's adopted into a family of Black kids, Chinese, and First Nations. So why I want to stand on the front lines of this is because, you know, I think about my little cousins. I think about all the race, all the different things that happened in my family because of race, or because, you know, we all didn't look the same as each other, or, you know, just the divide, people trying to break you down. So I've never seen race and just darker skin tone growing up in a game like hockey that is probably the whitest sport out of all the major ones in North America. It's tough because kids just kind of threw the book at me, didn't really know. They were just throwing racial slurs at me, seeing what would stick. And, you know, I tried not to let any of those fly because I was always thinking about my family. And so I don't fully understand, but, you know, I've gone through my own things, and I want to be there for y'all. And for the community, all my Black friends, all my Black family, you know, it even right now, you know, my hair is standing up talking about this. So, That's why I'm going to be a leader in our community and kind of hold true to the statement that I released a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing growing up for me was my parents would always say you have to be twice as good to get half the results. So it was always this chip on your shoulder that you have to go perform above and beyond all your peers to, you know, get some sort of recognition or some sort of achievement in this world. And when you're young, you don't really know why. You know, now that I've done, you know, my research, I know the history, I know everything that's gone on in this country. It's now you know why that phrase has come about, why people have said those, why your parents have taught you that, ingrained you in that. And so it's a lot of little lessons that you just learn through, I guess, osmosis, through your parents, just how to behave in public and not bring attention to yourself, and, you know, just a lot of little things. And I spoke a lot with, you know, some friends this morning just about the little micro levels of racism that's, you know, you go into a store and, you know, you feel compelled to buy even a stick of gum or something. You don't want to walk out back out of the store empty handed, not buying anything. You know, it's crazy that you have to even think like that, you know, or you're walking down the street and, you know, there might be, you know, a white woman in front of you. You don't want to seem menacing or, you know, like appear threatening to her. So you might slow up your walk or change size of the street, or you don't wear your hoodie. It's so many little things that, you know, that take their toll and you have to be always aware, always conscious. So it's a lot. It's like, it's a big thing. It's like the major overt racism, and, you know, we see it come to a head with police brutality, but there's so many little things that happen day to day, moment to moment, that you have to be aware of. And, you know, it just puts a chip on your shoulder. And, you know, I go back to the phrase, like, you have to be twice as good to get half the result. I think that is, you know, being Black in America right now, is you have a chip on your shoulder.
Yeah, I think, you know, being an African-American man is definitely something that you are very self-aware of, kind of like he spoke about, you know, just being out in public, you know, walking down the street, you often, you know, think you can be perceived as a threat, and you often see signs, subtle signs that, you know, someone may feel that you're a threat, you know, like he mentioned, walking across the street or you know, a woman, you know, walking with her hands to her side with her purse on her shoulder. And she goes from, you know, that one arm swinging to, you know, that one arm kind of reaching and making sure her bag isn't swinging out. It's little things like that, that I'm not even sure the person doing those things are aware that we're aware of what's going on, but it's definitely something that, you know, you noticed, or something that you even have to consider just to, you know, make that person feel comfortable. You know, it's a bit of a, you know, an extra step that crosses your mind that maybe I should do this because I just want to be viewed as normal and I just want to make that person feel as comfortable as possible. So often you have to make yourself uncomfortable by some of the things you have to do, or you have to be very, you know, out there that, you know, you're not trying to come off as a threat by, you know, just speaking to somebody, which is, you know, very normal. And you think, you know, that everybody does it, but that's just something that's like, okay, let me say something or let me smile to show that, you know, I'm not gonna, you know, bother you or hurt you. But I mean, I think for me growing up in Richmond, Virginia, where it's a pretty diverse community or a lot of, you know, African-American people around, you don't really have to do those things as often. But I think going to college, went to the University of Virginia, where it's predominantly white school, that's where I think it kind of popped up the most, as far as being very aware, and just, you know, if they see you and they know that you're a student, you know, it's okay. It's like, okay, this person's a UVA student, they're fine. But we did have locals that lived in the area. And oftentimes, if you didn't dress in a particular way, that they would consider you, you know, or think that you were local and they would treat you differently. I remember the one experience I had. I was in a burger spot one weekend, and I'm in the line, and just out of nowhere, I heard, you know, a white guy behind me say a racial slur about how he hates, you know, a particular race. And I turned around and I asked him, I was like, what'd you say? And he's like, oh, none. I was talking to my friend. So, you know, I didn't say it in a defensive way or, you know, aggressive way or even aggressive posture. I just wanted to see if he'd say it again. And he was like, oh, I didn't say anything. So, you know, I let him know that, you know, I heard what he said, and that I was just like, I'm not sure about your past experiences or why you're opinion, or what would even trigger you to say that. But I was just like, you know, I think you should be a bit more careful in saying that. And I guess for me, my thought went into, you know, this is a person who already has a negative perception of me. And we haven't talked. He just literally walked in the line behind me and could see the back of my head. So it was almost one of those things where, like, I felt bad for him that he even had to, you know, gesture that, or that he would feel that type of, you know, anger or hate or dislike towards me just for the color of my skin. And his friend body posture was one of, he seemed like he was kind of shocked, like he was a bit surprised. And I think it was more so where he was trying to be cool. You know, it was late at night. He had probably had a couple of drinks, and I think he was trying to say what he thought might have been cool at the time. But afterwards, you know, I heard his friend like, yo, man, that wasn't cool at all. Like, kind of like calling him out on it. And I believe that it came from a genuine place in him saying that, just by, you know, the body language and everything, and just kind of how it came about. But that was my one experience. It's like, you know, no matter where you go, being an African-American man, there's always a perception about, you know, who you are or how you're supposed to dress. And had I been dressed a particular way, he might have not even said it. But I think it was the fact that I was, you know, I was dressed down to like, you know, just sweatpants and hoodie, grabbing food. And he expressed those thoughts because I was Black and because I wasn't dressed like him too as well. So I just think about like times like that, or going in the store and having a cashier who's bagging, leave from bagging to essentially eye me and, you know, follow me down an aisle and act like he's putting something on the shelf and look at me a number of times, but never really ask if I need help. And then after I pick something up, then they want to, you know, come and pretend like they're doing something, but I can just tell they didn't put anything back on the shelf. They didn't grab anything from the shelf. It was just standing and pretending to look at something while, you know, I looked for whatever I was looking for. So I think it's just, you know, tough, and you always have to be aware or try to, you know, go out your way to make the other person feel comfortable.
All of that, I'm gonna lie to you. I've seen situations like that myself, particularly, you know, when it comes to, I think I don't fit necessarily a stereotype of what people think of when you think of like what a Black man is. You know, I get the, oh, you're so articulate, or and I'm like, okay,
let's go down that rabbit hole. Let's
right. So, and especially doing this, you know, it's like, oh, you're fine. You're one of the good ones. I'm like, I know what you mean by that. I don't really care for it, but that's what it is. And I think that brings us to a point where we look at like the illusion of sorts when we say everything's so inclusive now. But you look around and it may not necessarily be that way, particularly when you look at like representation in leadership. And I know the Timberwolves GM mentioned this yesterday, where there is that lack. But when you look at this, does it matter? Why does it matter?
For me personally, I guess on Monday there's an announcement of the HDA, Hockey Diversity Alliance. And kind of similar to what the NFL has going on with the Players Coalition. I was able to talk to Cap, via Zoom the last couple weeks. He jumped on a couple calls with, me and six other dudes. And it was really inspiring. Hearing everything that he had to say, all the advice, kind of speaked about how people in hockey will probably not take this. Not everyone's going to take this the right way, because some people do still have that perception that there is not racism in our game. But it is pretty naive to say something like that, being the most predominantly white sport. And just our goals of HDA is just to eradicate racism and start in the grassroots, and teach kids the difference and how to love one another. So in forming this alliance, I've had a lot of different conversations this past week about different scenarios people have been put in over the years, different things that have happened in hockey. It just saddens me to know that the sport like I love so much, that I grew up loving so much, I've made such good friends from, you know, has these problems deep down within it. And, you know, that's why I'm standing on this board and, you know, wanting to make a difference. So I'm calling out to, you know, everyone in the hockey world and in society to, you know, help this change and really, really make it better, because so many kids have been turned away from the sport, not only because how expensive it is, that's one of our goals to make it more accessible, but also, you know, I've had kids come in the locker room, kids from Minnesota playing minor hockey there, that have faced racism, and, you know, they don't want to play no more, you know, because they go through it on a daily basis, and kids shouldn't have to be scared to be a victim of racism doing something that they love, So that, like, that hurts me knowing, like, at the core of our game that there's something genuinely wrong and driving these kids away. Like, imagine if you could tap into a region, you know, like a state that knows nothing about hockey, or, you know, just has a few hockey programs that can encourage more players to play that are Black, that are minorities. You know, our game has grown so much in the last 10 years with speed and just how big guys are working out. There's how many great athletes are we missing out on? And that's what I want to bring attention to and hopefully create some more diversity in hockey.
Yeah, I think soccer has the same issue where you said, like, how expensive it is to play at a young age. You know, you got to drive a certain distance to play at a top level team, or you have to pay club fees or pay for tournaments. And I think that's, I mean, I think maybe football and basketball or baseball even are a little bit different in terms of, it's easier to play with their, you just need, it's easier to play just like street, or, you know, just get out there with the neighborhood kids. But I guess soccer doesn't really, you can do that, but to get to the professional level or get seen by colleges, it seems like you have to be the one that's paying the money to travel to a tournament in Florida to be seen by college coaches. And yeah, that's definitely a hurdle, I think, like, that you're addressing in hockey. It's the same that needs to be addressed in soccer. And there's so many talented kids that, you know, just can't afford to be seen. You know, they're the ones playing with just their local team at the local park, and they're incredible, they're sick, but they just won't be seen by the right people to have the game transform their life.
Yeah, and it's the whole system that all of those leagues and minor leagues and growing up, you know, you said the summer league, a prep team or an elite team, whatever. Yeah. It's the whole system that it's built around. And, you know, that is so unfortunate. And I've seen something I posted. It was just equity and equality. Quality, like, looking, just giving everyone equal. Equity is actually raising those people up so that they can get to that actual and equal playing field, not just giving everyone the foot box to stand on. Because some people, you know, where they come from economically, that's a huge hurdle. Like, I know probably some of y'all had to go through this stuff, but I watched my parents, you know, just scratch and claw. You know, to get me to play hockey. My dad's doing every job. He's got, like, all these different side hustles. He's reffing hockey at night. Like, this man didn't sleep for, like, a good 10 years, it felt like. And, you know, it got me here today. So, like, I love my family and that. But some people, you know, you don't have that you don't have that structure. Or and we got to help. We got to help those people out. We got to help those families out. And if for me, as much as my parents did, it really took a village to raise me. And so, like, shout out to the person, Pat Lawton. He was the owner of our local hockey rink. Shout out to, like, Bruce Randall, Brent DeVoe. Like, there's just the list goes on of, like, coaches and hockey coaches that, you know, just made it all happen. You know, would let registration slide for my parents. You know, were getting me equipment, were donating stuff to us. And driving me around. So it is cool when you can see that actually happen, and I just know it can work. So if everyone can pitch in on something like this, we could have a whole generation of athletes that, you know, didn't have to face those things. Like, where could they be? Like, it's almost unimaginable what levels they could be on if they didn't have to fight through some of those struggles.
Yeah, I guess had a question. I don't even know if I have a way to pose it as a question, but in terms of, like, diversity and people in power, specifically in sports, but I guess it can apply to the business world as well. Like, it's not happening organically, but we have rules in place that they're still not happening. Like, we can look at football with the Rooney Rule. There's, you know, you're required to interview a minority candidate, but still there's only two coaches and two or three GMs who are Black, even though the sport is overwhelmingly Black. So it's, you want the diversity of the people in power to happen organically, and it's not right now, but then there's rules in place to have it happen, and it's still not. But even in the business world, you want people to be hired, you know, but then you're like, oh, you're an affirmative action hire. And so, like, how much weight or credence is given to your work if people are already belittling it with saying it's you're an affirmative action, so we're not really listening to you. We're only hired you just to pass the quota or the minimum number. So, I mean, it's tough to, like, regulate that. I don't know how I'm going to say it as a question, but it's tough to regulate that and make sure that you have a bunch of voices and diversity and backgrounds in the positions of power. But then you also want it to happen organically so that their voices are actually heard and, you know, people actually hold weight to what they're saying.
Yeah, I think that's trying to, you know, find a way to start to allow that to form organically is, you know, the question that everybody's trying to figure out right now. You know, you put rules in place to try to, you know, allow opportunities to become available, but you know, like you said, they're not as often as they probably could be. There's probably, you know, a number of people who could be qualified for a position, but they just for some reason still don't get it, and they're not allowed to get it. I think, you know, that diversity and inclusion can't do anything but help. You know, looking in my arena, NFL, you know, the percentage of African-American players, and then you look around at, you know, the African-American employees and some of the executive or, you know, front office positions, there's not a lot of representation there. But I do believe that that presence could be one that would help elevate the organization and essentially eliminate, you know, some of the problems that we're having. You know, you think back to, you know, the disconnect from the players up until, you know, the front office at times, or even just promoting a message, you know, a marketing, from a marketing standpoint. You know, I think having someone from a different background, a different perspective, who's been raised maybe in a slightly different culture, it allows, you know, to somewhat, you know, filter, or I guess is what kind of what I'm looking for, not filter in a sense of in a negative way, but, you know, kind of challenging one another to come up with ideas that'll, you know, be a positive message to everyone. And that everyone will feel included and feel like they can become part of what's being advertised. I think that would be a nice step towards, you know, making some of these sports that we're talking about, baseball, hockey, making it attractive to, you know, people from different demographics and different backgrounds who may not have even thought about playing hockey. I just think for myself, I've never played. And I just remember it being pretty similar to, you know, rollerblading, but I've never played hockey. But I think, you know, given the opportunity to maybe just, you know, go to an ice rink and try it out would be a fun experience, you know. Not to say that I would have pursued a career, but it's just not to say I would have pursued a career, but I think part of life is it trying to experience, you know, the different things in life and figuring out, you know, where you want to go, what you want to be. Because I think at a young age, you really have no idea. You're just kind of going with the wind. So I think to have that option to dive into different sports and have those be accessible for you, regardless of your economic, did I cut out?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay, regardless of your economic position, I think it allows you to, you know, pursue that and it'd be an outlet or a potential something that you want to get involved in.
It does. First of all, I think we just made a great connection there, because I think, Matt, you need to get him on the ice, dude. Just
I was sitting here thinking, like, why don't I grab all three of you? And one day we go to the pitch. The other day we go to the football field.
I've been on the ice since I was probably 10 years old.
Since you're 10?
Yeah, I need that.
Yeah, it'd be bad.
Can any of y'all skate?
No, I need that bucket in front of me so I don't fall over and <Me too. laughs> land on my butt. Yeah. Oh, that's
funny. Probably score a goal, though, in soccer.
It does sound like there's some pretty systemic problems, though, that are pretty deeply rooted, that are just now – we're just scratching the surface, it sounds like, with this change. And people are kind of waking up in a large way, and that to see sort of like this Hockey Diversity Alliance and Anthony's, you know, social justice committee that and all this stuff, it just seems like these are the things that maybe can it within the leagues that you're playing in enact some real change. I mean, it seems like you guys are all sort of on the forefront of what could be a really powerful shift in this country. Do you feel that way?
Most definitely. And, you know, talking to Cap, you know, he expressed how we should go about this with the unity. But also, I think one thing I took away from those conversations is don't put ourselves as minorities in our sport in a box either. You know, we got dreams of where this game can go and who we having everyone involved. You know, we're not going to settle for anything less than that.
Yeah, I think,
you go ahead. I was just going to kind of build on that to say, I think we're fortunate to be, you know, athletes with this, because millions of people feel this way, but we are the ones that have the platform to kind of make that change, because more people are watching us or listening to us. So we kind of have a responsibility to voice our opinions and try to make change for people who can't.
Yeah, I think that was the point that I was going to make, that, you know, part of having this platform and part of, you know, being who we are as, you know, leaders in our own respective communities. And also just, you know, being leaders and influencers for not just our community, but for the whole world. You know, I'm pretty sure everybody has a very diverse following. And I think it's our job to, you know, kind of speak up and allow the voice of the unheard to be heard. I also believe it's our responsibility to bring one another closer together. You know, whether that's, you know, the same relationships that we build within the locker room with people from, you know, all over the world, different parts of the country, you know, sometimes even from a totally different country. I think it's that unique bond that we share that we want everybody to experience, you know, from our closest relatives to, you know, some of our close friends to a total stranger. You know, I think we all are blessed with this large platform and the ability to do all these great things, but also the ability to, you know, meet other great people, not just other good athletes. I think it's really eye-opening, and it really shows you a glimpse of, if we can look around in some of the locker rooms and build these type of connections with people who were once strangers, who know they don't look like me and they didn't grow up with the background that I had, but getting to know them as a person is something special. I think that's really what our duty as, you know, big influencers and leaders in the country to do, is to just bring everyone closer together and try to show that, you know, we can love one another, and that, you know, it may be only one position at a specific workplace, but we're not really, even though we may be competing against each other for that job, we're not on different teams. It's more so, you know, the mindset that we're trying to push. It's just like, there's enough space And there's a lot of jobs out here, and you know, it's all about just trying to carry and act in the right way. That's a good representation of, you know, being an upstanding person in society.
And this is kind of with the sports thing. I was watching like Remember the Titans the other day, which I know is like a really sugar-coated version, obviously, but that's like the beautiful thing about sports is you all come together for one common goal, to beat the other team. And you learn about other people. Like when I got to college, I learned about different religions, different like ethnicities, races when I got there, because you come together with those people who are from different parts of the world than you are, or the country. And I just feel like a big part of that is people aren't educated, and through sports, we are able to do that because we come together with people who are so different from our backgrounds.
What gives you guys hope right now?
I think we've all touched on it a little bit, is just how we've seen the just mass number of, you know, different people coming together. And like she just said, is coming towards to fight that common goal. And racism and this injustice and oppression. So I think that's it.
Yeah, I think conversations like this, you know, the various companies that have, you know, put out their, you know, their commercials, their statement, the worldwide protest, it seems, you know, I mean, we're still so close to the actual, you know, we haven't, you know, gone far enough away from, you know, George Floyd's murder to see what lasting cause, what lasting change will happen. But it seems like, you know, in my view, it's almost like this is kind of like the last straw, the final straw. You know, I hope I'm correct in believing in that, and, you know, sensing that from how everyone's been talking since the incident. But, you know, it seems like a lot more people are committed to this, not just the Black community, not just a few people you see around or the people you talk to. It seems like it's a worldwide conversation. So, you know, I hope, like I said earlier, I hope this is, you know, something we're still working towards a year from now, years from now. But right now, it seems promising.
And I think the willingness for people to become educated is really hopeful. And also what I've kind of noticed is this seems like kind of a young person movement. So it's like our generation, who are going to be the future of the nation and the world, are the ones who are really most passionate about this, is kind of what I've seen. So I think that's really hopeful, that the people who are coming into these things are the ones who want the change the most.
Yeah, I think that's the really important piece for me. I just have a lot of faith in, you know, I don't even really say hope, but I just have strong faith in what I believe in, and you know, I just think that, you know, we're all, you know, children of God. You know, whether, you know, you believe that in yourself, or whether you unknowingly you know, just believe that we are all human. I think that, you know, it is going to be, you know, an uphill battle, just because it's taken years to get ourselves in this position. But I think, like she spoke to, the fact that we have such a young audience that is very influential, very outspoken, and the fact that the audience is diverse, it gives us an opportunity that, you know, one day these are individuals who will be, you know, step into leader positions, whether it's corporations, government official spots. It's literally the future of our country. So I think the diversity that's at the table speaking out in hopes of, you know, just speaking out towards what's right is right, and that we're all equal, I think is very important. And I think they are able to portray a message you know, in their household, to their family members, one that, you know, other individuals from another race may not be able to do. I think, you know, once you have an individual from a very similar background, you know, talking to you, giving you perspective or sharing the knowledge about how they feel, I think it really makes you start to question, if you don't see or understand what's going on, are you even missing something? So I think that's the step, is just getting those questions out there, finding those, you know, words or conversations or images or videos that trigger that emotion of, am I missing something? Or do I not quite understand what it is that I'm seeing or what it is that I'm hearing? I think that those conversations and support across the board from such a young audience, and individuals that'll, you know, soon grow into, you know, older adolescents and have and create their own individual families and install them with those ideas of, you know, regardless of race, we are all human and we are all equal. That's why I think there's a lot to be, you know, thankful for and look for as far as progress.
I can't thank you folks enough. I just think this is such good dialogue, such important dialogue. A lot of times, you know, people say stick to sports. You know, they tell me that sometimes when I start veering out of my lane a little bit. But I just applaud you all for not sticking to sports and making this sort of a forefront issue as it needs to be, because I really do believe we're at a huge tipping point here.